study the informal development here in the world.
Okay, so we have six sessions in, sorry, six papers in this session. So I think we agreed about 10 minutes for each one, and then 5 minutes for discussion. So I think we can start with
Dr. Arif Atayya
Shamandi.
The title is Quality of Life in Disease as Components of City Prosperity Initiatives and Their Role in Enhancing Livability and Sustainability of Egyptian Cities.
So please go ahead.
So it's an honor having you here with us today. My presentation about using the quality of life indicators as a part of the City Prosperity Initiative to enhancing sustainability and livability in the Egyptian cities. I don't know if you actually visited any Egyptian cities, especially our colleagues from outside Egypt. But trust me on this one. If you do, you will find major and chronic issues related to the quality of life. We can't tackle these issues without a real knowledge of their extent. Consequently, we should attain stats, numbers, values, or what we city planners like to call indices or indexes. Speaking of which, our main objective behind our research is to utilize such indices to activate sustainability and livability in our Egyptian cities. Eventually, on the long run, a higher quality of life is attained. The research has the following aims: to improve planning and management process of our cities, to make more practical, informed, and better planning decisions toward livable and sustainable cities. To cover the research element, my presentation today consists of five parts: the City Prosperity Initiative, the quality of life issues in the Egyptian cities, measuring quality of life, the local case study, conclusion, and recommendation. The first part is the City Prosperity Initiative. City Prosperity Index is a global initiative which was initiated in 2012 by the UN Habitat. It works as a global monitoring mechanism to measure sustainability and prosperity dimensions all over the world. This initiative has goals which can be looked at here. To make cities livable places, to allow cities to be able to withstand and recover from crisis, plan the cities of tomorrow for sustainability based on quality of life, environmentally sound and carbon efficient cities, build socially inclusive and accessible, equitable and gender sensitive cities. Now, the City Prosperity Index consists of six main dimensions. These dimensions are the environmental sustainability, the equity and social inclusion, infrastructure, productivity, and lately they added legalization, and the most importantly, quality of life. The quality of life, as I mentioned, has a lot of values and indicators, which we will zoom in on later on. The second part of the presentation is the quality of life issues related to the Egyptian cities. Really, it's a very complicated process to determine such issues in our Egyptian cities and in our Arab cities. That is due to the absence of data and also due to the difficulty phase in getting them. To determine such issues, I had to visit a lot of these cities, studying the socio-economic condition, their actual situation, and also I had to study their old plans and the strategic plans from the GOBB. And what were our findings? The huge increase in population does affect the country development resources. Because of the lack of procedures to absorb these issues. There is an imbalance between the populated and unpopulated areas in Asia. 6% of the country areas for people reside around 0.9. And all the attempts to expand our populated area did fail. And why is that so? Because there is an absence of the quality of life principles in our Egyptian cities, especially the newest one and the latest one. Most of them, not all of them, most of them. Such as the shortage in housing choices, the unsuitable roads network, public transport shortage and being in a poor condition, shortage in health and educational services and them being in low quality, the absence of the planning for pedestrians. All these issues issues need us to work hard to find solutions. These solutions will not take place without a real and measurable indicators. These real and measurable indicators lead us to part three, measuring quality of life. The experts who are interested in measuring quality of life developed four main domains, which works as a container of the quality of life indicators. These domains are the social domain, the urban domain, the economic domain, and the political domain. In this table, we can see the four domains and its indicators, and each indicator of this have a sub-indicator to be measured. This is one of the social domain indicators, called school children in the classroom. I show that because I want to tell you that every indicator has a definition, an indicator elements, and a methodology. The way to calculate this indicator, this was established from the UN Habitat in the City Prosperity Index. Finally, the result of the indicator, and this is a global comparative result. We can compare this indicator in any city with another city. We can compare the indicator in Abuja, in Cairo, with the same indicator in other cities all over the world. Also, we can compare this indicator, this result, with the world standard, which is established from the UN Habitat, maximum and minimum. And we can compare this indicator with the maximum and minimum since prosperity benchmark, which was established, I thought, from the UN Habitat. The first part of my presentation is the local case study. We choose Burj Al Arab as a local case study because it's one of the first new generation cities in Egypt. It was established in 1971 by the Egyptian government. The city was established as an independent residential industrial city with a very strong base of industrial and with a very strong industrial base. The city was aimed to reach 500,000 of people in 2015. I want to tell you that the city now is about 150,000 only. When we study Burj Al Arab, we knew that we had to collect more data, and there's a big absence of the data. So we decided to make a socio-economic survey. It was about 5% of the households in the city, equal to 1,250 samples. This is the form of the socio-economic survey, and it takes us about 15 days. In the city with a big team, about 10 or 15 persons in the city. After collecting all the data and producing the available indicators, because this is some of these indicators we couldn't produce because it related to the government or something like this. The city indicators didn't show a big difference between Burj Al Arab issues and the other Egyptian cities issues. Especially the latest one or the newest one. These issues, these indicators give us a lot of issues. I can't present all the issues in this short presentation, but in the board, the meeting board. So I will give you an example of these issues. When we look to these three indicators, the unemployment rate 7%, the work journey time 25 minutes, and the informal employment rate 56.8%, that gives us that most of the workers come from outside the city. And a daily round trip from Alexandria, by the way, Burj Al Arab is one of the metropolitan region of Alexandria, and it's about 60 kilometers away from Alexandria. And only the poor workers and the indigenous people live in the city. When we asked them why that, they told us because there's a shortage in the services in the city, in the health, educational services, health services, green areas, places to entertainment. So especially the technical person, engineering managers, live in Alexandria and go and back to the city. Another example of these issues, that all the buildings in the city have a 100% infrastructure completed, even the empty buildings. And this is a big waste in infrastructure resources. And also when we look to these indicators, length of four route per capita and the route intersection density, we have a high percent here, but we have a high percent of the routes implementation, but it's in a poor condition, and the public transportation in these routes is in a poor condition. One of the most important issues in the city is the buildings called Ibn Baytak, which translates as build your own home. This project, I'm sorry, it's an example of a failure project in our Egyptian cities, in our new Egyptian cities. It ended up like a cemetery of non-functional and non-finished buildings. Small areas, bad elevations, empty buildings, and with completed infrastructure network. Finally, all this improved my hypothesis in the research that we are inventing to a measurable and accurate methodology based on measurable indicators in our planning and the conclusion and recommendation. One of the most important recommendations is the redefining of our planning and development borders, because our planning borders now are administrative borders. We need to make it development borders and planning borders. I think they begin in that in 2030 plan now. Also, we should change our planning methodology to be based on a measurable and accurate indicator, such as the city prosperity indicators or any other practical indicators. We think that establishing urban observatory zones in the all of the Egyptian cities will help us improving the planning process, because there's an absence of data in our cities, and also this will help us collecting the data and producing the indicators or the available indicators we need. And its quality of life applications and indices indicators should be established depending on our local condition, and that's very important, depending on our local conditions. And also a sub-index for housing, roads, services, and so on and so forth is desperately needed. This was my humble presentation. I appreciate your presence. Thank you.
Said that you want to have a sort of index or I mean benchmark for each individual. So I was going to ask you, is it a universal one? But you said that it is going to be a local one.
We work in this in a lot of cities. A lot of cities. I am, by the way, the manager of Urban Observatory for 10 cities in Saudi Arabia. We found that every city has its local condition. So the benchmark should be able the city condition. That's very important. For example, I will give you an example for this. In a city called El Baha in Saudi Arabia, they put that the infrastructure network should have five elements. One of them is sewage. All the city doesn't have the sewage. That means that this is an slum area? No. So it's very important to make our indicators as a local indicators, not even universal indicators.
I have a question and a comment. In your recommendations, you are stressing the field of data gaining and data precising and monitoring, things like that. Do you really believe that this is the real cause for the deficit that you have identified with your very nice research? In my eyes, you know, if you don't, you have a unified planning law in Egypt, you have planning institutions on the local and on the government level. Where are they doing which job? Finding new indicators and measuring new situations will not help when the planning institutions do not implement. This is my comment and a question at the same time.
Okay. We have a lot for that. We have a lot of data in Egypt. But we need to revise this data to Tawheed here. Make it, we have the, we need benchmarks to reach for it. Benchmarks to reach for it. There's a lot of data. And everyone working in this process, in the planning process, use this data by his mind, by his experience. But what I told you is that we need a methodology and benchmarks to reach for it. And this benchmark and methodology should be dependent on our local condition.
Yeah, I would agree to that, but the problem is you have done an ex post analysis of given situation. Okay, but what does this teach us now for the future? Who should act? I remember you on Professor Nagoshi yesterday, he said we should act now. Who should act now to improve the situation or to avoid such situations in new planning cases?
I think we need to change a lot of our laws in planning, and we should make a, for like the JOBP, for example, and the housing minister, we should make this, take a look for our laws, our regulations, and then begin to fix it.
Totally agree with what you're saying, and so far also with our presenter, but the question is, obviously in these cases here, on this special case, or in other cases, yesterday we had similar presentations in another session, obviously the planning institutions are not following this idea. Otherwise it would be not the situation like it is. I don't say it's everything something bad, but if there is a solid analysis given to us, then the question is how can we change it and how can we avoid such developments in the future? This is
very important question. How can we do that? That's a very important question. So we'll try to talk in this conference with the authorities of the planning in Egypt. In this conference, there's a lot of new ideas and researches. We have to tell them and speak with them and try with them to change them.
The issue is to be adopted by the authorities.
Yes. So I must speak about it a little bit. It's for the low-costing housing. Epimetac is an idea, but on the real world, it's not a very good one.
May I say something? That we have, last summer, we had a project with our students here in Cairo, one of the students is sitting here, on an Epimetac area in 6th of October. What I have seen there is some 1,000 buildings nearly finished, but all not occupied, finished and constructed with private money to 80%. And why are they not used and occupied? Because there is no infrastructure, there are no social services, there is no private services. And we had assemblies with the citizens there. One night in Ramadan, in the Ramadan tent, we talked with 40 people, owners, and they told us, okay, we would come, but the situation is as it is. So they had